各位朋友，大家晚上好啊！那欢迎大家参加我们由 MentoringCo 导师学院以及组织隐形技能管理全球智库 GO-TKM 联合举办的组织隐形技能管理全球智库大师课程系列讲座。那今天呢，是我们讲座的，
我们这个讲座总共会有50场。
那么，本期呢是第14场。今天晚上呢，我们有请到来自于荷兰的 Jasper 先生给大家主讲。在我们主讲之前呢，让我们首先来认识一下今天晚上的主讲嘉宾。那你看到这个这么一个帅哥级的导师啊，来讲这个今天晚上这个主题。那今天晚上跟我们讲什么呢？讲基业长青。组织如何有效传承专家的技能，因为每个组织里面都有很多专家，如何把专家的技能进行传承啦？那今天晚上我们来细细的听我们的专家跟大家分享。在我们开始之前呢，我们来认识一下我们的演讲嘉宾。那我们演讲嘉宾呢，他是飞利浦全球知识管理官，那么他也曾经以前担任过 Feadership 前任知识管理官，他以前曾经在空客公司、防务和航空公司的工程担任过工程师。那他呢，他的专长是非常擅长于做知识管理的战略的制定、实施、数字知识管理、专业知识管理以及变革管理、利益相关的管理、专家型人才管理啊。他也发表过多篇关于知识管理的相关文章，其中一篇叫《成功的知识管理：通向未来的》。路线图，这个曾经获得第二届知识管理和治理资本卓越奖，这是很了不起的啊！并且呢，我们的今天晚演讲嘉宾呢，他也多次在国际会上就知识管理话题做演讲嘉宾啊。所以今天晚上呢，我们最近挑的全都是大公司，全球这种大公司专业的实战派的老师给大家去分享。我们不仅仅是在讲这个叫理论上的，跟大家去讲一些空对空的东西。我们在实际上做的是一些实战派的专家跟大家分享组织隐形技能管理实践。OK。那么在我们讲之前呢，我们还会去了解一下、介绍一下我们今天晚上这个活动的主办方。那这个活动主办方呢，就像前面我讲的，我有两方，一方呢是由 MentoringCo 导师学院。另一方呢是组织隐形技能管理全球智库。那么MentoringCo 公司呢是一家总部位于比利时布鲁塞尔的全球化导师服务咨询公司。它的业务呢遍布全球6大洲35个国家和地区。那它所提供的所有的导师技术课程、服务流程和标准以及服务团队均获得欧洲导师教练协会的专业认证。那么组织隐形技能管理全球智库，它是一家注册于比利时布鲁塞尔的非盈利性国际智库，它旨在推动组织隐形技能管理在全社会的运用以及推动人类的高效率学习。 OK。 那么然后呢，我们每期的讲座里面呢都有我们的 PPT和一些相关的阅读资料，欢迎各位朋友呢扫码入群，然后呢联系我们的工作人员获得相应的 PPT 以及相关资料，好吗 ？OK, now let's welcome Mr. Jasper. Give us a wonderful speech. Now, Jasper, over to you. Thank you.
Yeah. So thank you, Fisher, and thank you all for.For having me in this webinar, and also for your time and effort in joining this webinar. It's really a pleasure for me to be here with you all. My name is Jasper Lavertu, and I'm the Global Knowledge Management Practice Manager of Philips. And actually, as we speak, I'm calling from our headquarters in Amsterdam in the Netherlands.
感谢金水刚才的介绍，非常高兴今天能在这里跟大家见面。然后也感谢 Fisher 的邀请，然后感谢各位 能够花时间和精力参加今天的讲座。我首先自我介绍一下，我叫 Jasper， 然后我是飞利浦的全球知识管理官，我现在在我们荷兰阿姆斯特丹的总部给大家做这个演讲。
Yeah, and as I mentioned, I'm looking at Philips, and Philips is a leading health technology company operating globally. We have roughly 75,000 employees, and with a presence all over the world. And actually, our biggest markets are in Europe, in China, and in the United States.
飞利浦是一家领先的健康科技公司，我们的业务遍及世界各地，然后现在大概有 7.5 万名员工，然后我们最大的市场是在欧洲、中国和北美地区。
And as a health technology company, you can imagine that we need and that we have a lot of experts to deliver on our promise to our customers and the patients. And to be honest, meeting customer and patient expectations is not always that easy, unfortunately. And if you see the news lately about Philips, you can conclude that we at Philips could, but also should do better. But that only strengthens my belief that what we should do, is everything possible to empower the organization's experts to create the necessary sustainable business impact.
作为一家
，You're muted, I see.
Yes.作为一家全球的健康科技公司，大家可以想象我们有很多的专家，当然我们也需要这么多的专家来帮助我们实现我们对客户和患者的承诺，但也说实话，去满足客户和患者的期望也并不总是那么容易，因为如果大家注意到最近的新闻的话，其实也可以发现我们飞利浦是可以而且应该做得更好，但这个它只会增强我的信念，就是我认为我们应该尽一切的可能去为我们的专家赋能，然后让他们帮助我们为这个组织创造可持续的商业影响。
Yeah, so we really need those experts to flourish, so they can play their parts in creating the products and solutions for our customers and patients that really provide value for them, the solutions that really support them in achieving better health outcomes.And fortunately, in most cases, we do quite a good job. Not in all cases, but most of them, yes, we are doing quite a good job.
我们需要这些专家，他们需要他们的成长，他们的发展，然后以便他们去发挥自己的作用，为我们的客户和患者去创造有价值的产品和解决方案。当然，也比较幸运的是，我们在大多时候做的这方面做的还是比较好的。
Yeah, and before jumping to my story about how we at Philips empower the experts to create this sustainable impact, it is good to briefly talk about definitions.
在我跟大家分享我们在飞利浦是如何为专家赋能，然后从而为我们整个公司都能够带来可持续的商业影响之前，我们先来简单的看几个定义。
So in knowledge management research, but also within the knowledge management community worldwide, there's a lot of attention going to, let's say, the different types of knowledge. That could be explicit or tacit or implicit. But you also see that there's, yeah, no clarity on its exact definition. Depending on whom you ask, you might get a slightly different perspective on it.And I understand the confusion because it could be rather vague, right? I mean, even the term knowledge could be a bit ambiguous. What is the definition of knowledge actually? But as a practitioner, what I've learned the hard way, I must say, is that when talking to the business where the actual work is being done about knowledge management, it is best to avoid specific knowledge management jargon as much as possible.
在我们这个知识管理的世界，大家把很多的这个注意力都放在了这个，大家都在探讨这个知识的不同的类型， 它比如说有显性知识也有隐性的知识。然后在很多的这个研究中，但也发现就是对这个知识的定义并不那么明确，然后你可能问到就是不同的人，他们给出你的给你的答案可能是不一样的。然后我也理解这种情况的发生。然后其实知识这个词本身它其实也是有一点就是含糊的，有一点模糊的。那作为一名就是这个领域的从业者呢，然后我也学到了一些比较宝贵的东西，就是我觉得我们在跟企业去谈这个知识管理的时候呢，最好去尽可能的去避免那些行话那些术语。
Yeah, and I rather stay away from this specific knowledge management jargon as much as possible, because often during discussions there's a lot of focus going on to these definitions and creating clarity, and that only distracts from the actual message that we want to bring over, and the value that knowledge management could bring to them. And we should make life easier and better and not more complicated.
最尽可能的去避免就是跟相关人员去谈论这个行话术语，是因为如果把重点就是放在讨论这些术语的定义啊，然后去跟对方去怎么去具体的解释啊，这样可能会就是分散就是人们对这个知识管理所能带来价值的这个注意力，可能会淡化你所要想传递的这个实际信息。
Yeah, so I've learned that the exact definition of knowledge, explicit knowledge, tacit knowledge, implicit knowledge, it doesn't really matter to the end user. And it could be relevant, of course, for the purpose of research or for discussions in the knowledge management community. But for the end users of knowledge, it's not that relevant. And we should really try to translate it into the language that is being used by the people who actually apply and share and develop and maintain the knowledge on a day-to-day basis.
知识它不管是显性知识还是隐性知识，它的定义对最终的用户来说并不那么重要。可能我们在做这个知识相关的研究，或者说在这个知识管理领域的相关从业人员，大家在一起讨论的时候可能会涉及这个话题，但是对知识的这个使用者来说它就不那么重要了。所以我们需要是把那些就是行话术语转换成那些大家可能日常会应用分享就是维护知识的时候可能用的比较日常的那些语言。
So when talking about knowledge management with our stakeholders in the company, we are talking about building, maintaining, growing, and continuously improving the knowledge ecosystem. And the knowledge ecosystem is still a bit vague, I know. So what is the knowledge ecosystem? And we explain it as the three connected elements, communities of practice, experts, and digital knowledge assets.
那我们实际在跟公司的利益相关者谈论知识管理的时候，我们更多谈论的是如何去建立、维护和持续改进知识生态系统。那什么就是知识生态系统的？知识生态系统，我们把它主要解释为三个，然后相互关联的这个要素，分别是实践、社区、专家和数字知识资产。
So we have communities of practice, and to get the right people together so knowledge flows and grows around a specific topic. You have these digital assets, providing guidance on managing digital knowledge assets like manuals, work instructions, best practices, lessons learned, but it could also be videos or wikis, etc. And we have then the experts, how to empower these experts to create a sustainable business impact. And that will also be the topic of this talk.
我们来一一看一下这三个要素。首先，这个实践社区，实践社区主要是我们把就是相关的专业人员聚集在一起，然后让大家就某个主题，然后进行分享交流，这样就形成了知识的流动和增长。那数字资产这一块是我们为这个管理数字资产然后提供一定的指导，这个指导具体体现为就我们平时的使用的手册、工作指南、最佳实践视频、还有图表、播客等等。那专家的话就是我们今天要强调的主要话题，就是我们要为专家赋能，让他们为 组织带来可持续的商业影响。
Yeah, so what do we do to empower the experts? Because in the end, that's what we want to achieve. Right? So they are able to create the sustainable impact. And I strongly believe that we can do that best with a human-centric approach.
那我们怎样才能为专家赋能呢？因为这个归根结底是我们所要实现的目标。我个人认为我们应该去通过以人为本的方式来实现这一目标。
And when we look at the definition of an expert, and I took this general definition from the Oxford Advanced Learner's Dictionary, an expert is a person with special knowledge, skill, or training in something. But being an expert in itself is not enough, really, because we want them to become the so-called fountains of knowledge, how we call them.
那我们来看一下这个专家的定义，这个是我在那个牛津高阶英语词典上查到的。他说，专家是指在某方面具有特殊知识、技能或者接受过特殊培训的人。那我们让专家他成为专家本身自然是不够的，因为我们更多的是希望他能够成为组织内部知识的源泉。
So we want experts to drive relevant topics within the organization.And we want them to share their knowledge and provide thought leadership proactively. And we want them to act as influencers and role models, because only then they can create the impact that we need. So how can we create these fountains of knowledge? But let me first pause for IC translation.
Yeah, thank you. 那我们自然是希望就是专家他能够在组织内部推动相关的议题，然后我们希望他们能够分享自己的知识，然后积极的去扮演一个思想领导者的角色。然后我们也希望他们能够去起到这个影响力的榜样的作用，因为只有做这样的话，他们才能够创造出我们需要的那种影响力。
So for sustainable commitment from experts and to become that fountain of knowledge.We need to focus on the three drivers of behavioral change, capability, motivation, and opportunity.
为了让这些专家成为组织里知识的源泉，我们需要关注三个驱动因素。这三个驱动因素是涉及到行为变化的，分别是能力、动机和机会。
Yeah, this so-called COMB system,was developed by Susan Michie, Maartje van Stralen, and Robert West. And they assessed 19 existing frameworks related to behavioral change interventions and proposed this new, improved framework involving the three essential conditions, capability, opportunity, and motivation.
好，这个框架呢，它简称为 COMB 模型。然后这个模型是由这个 Susan Michie, 还有 Stralen, 还有Robert West 他们合力然后设计的一个框架，然后这个框架是他们就是基于已有的这个19个行为改变干预的框架，然后在此基础上设计了一个新的框架，然后这个新的框架呢就设计了这三个条件，就是能力、动机和机会。
So they defined capability as the individual's psychological and physical capacity to engage in an activityAnd it includes having the necessary knowledge and skills. And motivation was defined as all those brain processes that energize and direct behavior. And opportunity was defined as all the factors outside of the individual that make the behavior possible or prompted.
那他们将这个能力是定义为个人参与活动的身体和心理能力，这里呢就包括拥有正确的必要的知识和技能。那动机呢主要是被定义为是激发和引导行为的一个大脑过程。那机会是指能够是使行为成为可能或者是促使行为发生的以及个人以外的那些因素，比较是外在的因素。
So in this behavioral system, The the elements capability, motivation, and opportunity, they interact to generate the desired behavior. And that in turn influences these components. So it's all intertwined with each other. And the double-headed arrows in this figure on this slide represent the potential influence between the components in the system. And for example, opportunity can influence motivation, as can capability. And enacting a behavior can alter capability, motivation, and opportunity.
这三个因素呢，它们又是相互作用的，然后通过相互作用产生了行为，然后反过来又受到行为的约束。那这个图上大家看到这个箭头有的是双头的，那这个双头就表示它们各个因素之间都有潜在的这个互相的影响。比如说机会是可以影响到动机的，那能力也可以影响到动机。当我们去就产生只是一种行为的时候，是可以改变我们的能力、动机和机会的。
So let's translate this model to our context. If we look at capability, do people know, do the experts know what being a fountain of knowledge means for them? Is it clear what is expected from them? And do they have the right skills and experience to do so? And if you look at motivation, do people understand and feel why this is important for the organization and for our customers and patients? And do they see the benefits for themselves as well? Is it exciting and fun to be part of it? And looking at opportunity, is there a clear strategy? And is our governance supporting the experts to be the fountain of knowledge? Do we have the right processes and systems in place to enable them taking their role? Is our culture supporting them? So these kind of questions we should address if we want to create these fountains of knowledge. And in the following slides, I will explain how we approach this and ensure that the experts are capable, motivated, and have the opportunity to be the fountain of knowledge.
那我们把这个模型，然后就是把它应用到我们所处的这个环境里。比如首先在能力方面，那专家他是否知道这个知识的源泉对他们来说是意味着什么？然后是否知道我们对他们的期望，然后他们是否有这个足够的技能和经验来做到这一点。在动机方面，就是专家他是否理解能并且能感受到为什么就是这个对我们组织和客户来说是这么的重要，然后他们是否也看到这个对他们也有很多的好处，然后是成为其中的参与其中是否让他们能够感到兴奋，然后是否觉得这个很有趣。那机会这一方面就是说我们是否有一个明确的战略，然后我们的管理是否给予了专家足够的支持，然后我们是否有比如说合适的这个程序或者系统来帮助他们发挥这个作用。那在后面呢，我会详细的跟大家讲我们如何确保专家他能够有能力、有动机、有机会成为知识的源泉。
Okay, so first capability. To make experts capable, we developed performance support for experts. And we developed those materials based on the 5 moments of need framework.
首先第一个能力的话，我们就是为了让专家有这个足够的能力，我们给予他们这个绩效支持。那这里呢，我们就设计了一些材料，然后这些材料呢是基于5需求时机框架。
And the 5 moments of need framework was developed by Dr. Konrad Gottfriedson and Bob Mosher. And backed by research,they argue that the best learning happens over time and in the flow of work, instead of, for example, through singular events. And this framework is helping to shift from a learning mindset to a performance mindset. And with that, enable effective and efficient performance in the flow of work. So basically, learning while working.
这个框架它是有这个 Conrad 博士和 Bob Mosher 然后开发的，他们也是基于一定的研究，然后得出结论，认为最好的学习是随着时间的推移，然后在工作的我们的流程中自然而然发生的。它并不是说只 局限在某一单一的学习事件中。然后这个框架是有助于就心态的转变，从这个学习的心态然后转为绩效低的这个心态，然后以此呢我们能够就是实现就是让我们的绩效然后得到有效的提升。简单来说就是让我们边工作边学习。
And there are five moments of need to learn while working. So first, there is new, when people are learning something for the first time. Then there's more, when people are expanding the breadth and depth of what they have learned. Then there's change, when people have to learn new ways of doing something. Solve, of course, when people have to solve a problem or resolve an issue because things don't work always the way they should. And apply when people have to act upon what they have learned.
那在工作中呢，我们常常有五个就我们需要学习的时机。首先，第一个是学习新知识的时机，这个就是发生在我们第一次学习某些东西或事物的时候。第二个呢是扩展已有知识的时机，这个主要是当我们想扩大我们所学知识的广度和深度的时候。我们就要想要学习更多。第三个是应对变化的时机，这个时机也是当我们就是有时候不得不去学习新的做事方式的时候。第四个是我们解决问题的时机，因为有时候我们就是我们可能做的事情或者任务它偏离了既定的轨道，然后我们不得不要去解决这个问题或者难题，然后这个时候呢就是学习也发生了。第五个就是应用的时机，应用时机就是指我们要把我们所学的东西变到实践当中。
And the performance support that I talked about is, provides aid to a person, in this case, the experts. At the moments of needs, to ensure the most effective performance. And actually, there's so much more to this framework, so I encourage you all to take a look at the website to learn more about it.
当我们在给予专家绩效支持的时候，这个时机就主要就发生在这个专家面临的这几个需求时机的时候，就在这个时候我们给予他们帮助，然后呢也就是确保他们的一个最有效的能够去提升他们的绩效。那这个五个需求时机框架还有涉及到更多的内容，大家如果感兴趣的话可以点击这个下方的链接然后去进一步的了解。
So, and to enable the performance support, we need to know and to understand the workflow. And to know the workflow, we conducted a rapid workflow analysis. And basically, we organized various brainstorming sessions with various well-recognized experts in the company and simply asked them what they do to be an effective and efficient expert.
那我们为了给专家这个绩效支持，我们首先是需要了解这个工作流程的。那为了了解这个工作流程，我们会进行一次快速的工作流程分析。那这个主要是我们比如说我们开展各种头脑风暴会议，然后让就各种各样的专家然后参与进来，然后在这个过程我们可以去就简单的问他们是如何做才能成为一位高效能的专家。
So, and then we had a whole list of activities that they execute and perform. And then we apply the principle of chunking, and that's grouping those job tasks into specific processes. And this chunking is helping to optimize the capacity of the mind to store and retrieve information from long-term memory. And we also gained more detail by identifying steps to execute on those tasks.And identified the knowledge that is needed to take these steps. And the supporting material for experts that we developed are again based on these knowledge needs in the flow of work.
然后我们就采用这个分块原则，就是将这个各种工作任务然后进行分组，然后分到这个特定的这个流程中。大家可以看这个右边的这个图。那这样分块呢，主要是有助于我们就是通过让我们的大脑通过这个长期的记忆我们可以去储存和检索信息，然后我们呢还需要 就是对确定这个完成这个任务它具体所需要的步骤，然后以及这每一个步骤你采取这些步骤的时候你所需要的那些知识。那我们为专家就设计的这个辅助材料呢，正是基于这些我们工作流程中所需要的知识。
Yeah, so, and as a result of the RWA, so the rapid workflow analysis, we labeled 6 processes that are important for experts, yeah, to play their role. And each of those processes are again then have several tasks in it, and of course, each task have several steps.
那经过这个快速工作流程分析以后呢，我们主要得出了六个，然后有助于我们专家发挥作用的这个过程。
So the six processes that we labeled, you can see them on this slide. So first of all, it was managing income requests. Experts receive a lot of requests for their expertise. So we did develop support to help them anticipate requests, to triage and verify income requests. And to identify the proper response to income requests.
这个六个然后过程呢，我们一一来看一下。就在右边的图，首先最上方是管理收到的请求，因为我们的专家他会收到很多关于他这个专业知识的请求，那所以我们要给予这个专家支持，然后帮助他去也是对这些请求进行分类和核实。
Another process label that we identified was supporting colleagues.And to respond to requests, we created support for experts in providing direct support to colleagues. And how, there are many ways that you can provide support, of course, but we try to provide instructions and knowledge to support them in doing, giving that support. But also indirect support, like collecting repeating questions and setting up an FAQ section, for example. It's just a simple example of a way to provide indirect support.
那除了这个管理收到的知识请求呢，还有就是去给同事支持，这个特别是主要是我们为了方便专家去回应这些请求，然后呢我们就对这些专家提供支持，这些支持呢可以是比较直接的也可以是间接的，像间接的就是我们可以为专家去收集这些问题，然后发现特别是有哪些可能是重复的问题，然后我们就去特别建立一个栏叫做常见问题栏，就是 FAQ.
Yeah, for educated people, you can think of, for example, how to give lectures. What should you do to provide high quality supervision to students? But also being a mentor to other people within the company. We have various mentoring programs in the company, which is really, really important.To transfer also the tacit knowledge from the experts to other people that are in need of that.
那第三个呢是叫指导他人，这个是比如说在组织内我们也可以举办一些讲座活动，然后我们可以就是比如说为有些可能扮演学生的角色，我们为这些学生然后提供一个辅导监督，或者是在组织内部我们可以形成这个导师辅导项目，然后由导师向学员。然后去辅导学员，然后向他分享自己的知识经验。那这个导师辅导项目也有助于我们在组织内部，然后形成这个隐性知识的分享和转移。
So the other one was measuring success and impact, of course, also very relevant. How to measure your own performance as an expert, and what can you do to also.Assess the impact of your contributions. It's a very important aspect.
第四个方面呢是也是非常重要的，就是衡量成功和影响。这个主要就是我们如何就是帮助专家去衡量他自己的这个表现，以及他作为专家，他给组织所带来的贡献，然后这个贡献所造成的影响。
Yeah, and then of course, there's the develop and maintain the expertise that experts want, but also need to stay up to date. They develop new knowledge, for example, through research or, and do regular expertise health checks and benchmarking. But also developing and maintaining the network is very important. And how to create an online presence, for example, within our company Yammer, but also on external sites like LinkedIn, but also support to participate in events and contribute to communities is part of that process label. And these are only just a couple of examples of, let's say, tasks of support that we provide within these identified process labels.
第五个是发展和保持维护我们的这个专业知识，跟我们的专家，他自然希望自己的知识是最新的，然后他也希望去拓展新的知识，比如说可以通过研究或者是定期进行这个专业的知识健康检查和基准测试。那第六个是这个能力是发展和维护这个人际网络，它包括如何在网络上然后建立树立自己的形象，比如我们在公司内部我们有 Yammer 这个平台，然后外部我们可以通过 LinkedIn 这些网站，然后我们也支持专家去多参与这些相关的活动，然后比如说也可以去参加各种各样的这个社群，然后让他们为这个社群也做出贡献。
Yes, I'll do it. Support the experts in the roles, we delivered an online guide with an equal structure as the output of the rapid workflow analysis. And we created various training materials. We're also actually setting up a community of practice for experts where they can share best practices, discuss challenges, and provide tips and tricks on being an effective and efficient expert.
那此外，我们就是还为我们的这个专家，就是为了方便他们去，然后发挥自己的作用，我们去就提供了在线指南。这个指南就跟刚才的那个快速工作流程分析的结构类似的。我们提供了各种各样的培训材料。然后另外，我们也就是组建了一个专家的社群，然后方便专家，然后在这个社群里可以分享他们的最佳实践，然后讨论他们遇到的难题挑战，然后也能够方便他们去分享他们成为一名专家的这个可能一定有技巧啊或者窍门。
So in addition to capable experts, we of course also want motivated experts. And as I mentioned, Philips is a leading health technology company and we have many, many medical experts in-house. And we actually did a short survey within the medical experts community of Philips and ask them what they find rewarding in being a medical expert. And on this slide, you see the results of that survey. And it's good to notice that, or to mention that the experts could indicate multiple rewards. So the outcome is the percentage of the total answers given.
那我前面有刚刚我们提到了这个专家的能力，现在我们来看一下这个专家的动机这个方面。那飞利浦是一家领先的健康科技公司，那我们内部有很多的医疗专家，我们在这个内部就对这些医疗专家做了一个简短的调查，就是我们问他们觉得就是哪些他们因素对他们来说是就是有益的，是有就是有价值的，对他们来说是真正有回报的。那在这张 PPT 大家可以看到这个调查结果，因为有的专家呢他的选择呢也是多个，然后认为有多个回报。那这个呢我们按这个百分比最后进行了一个排序。
Yeah, and what strikes me most was that none of them answered monetary rewards as being a motivator. And perhaps people thought they didn't want to give an undecided answer. But when I looked a bit also into research, it has been also properly researched. And it concluded in the various research that I saw that monetary rewards are indeed not a sustainable incentive for cognitive and creative and innovative work.
这些答案让我最吃惊的就是好像就是没有一个人回答说金钱回报然后对他们而言是一种激励因素，那也许是他们就是不想给一个可能不太受欢迎的答案。然后关于金钱奖励这一块， 实也有很多的研究，然后很多研究也表明，就是对于那些创造性的认知性的工作，金钱的奖励它是不能起到持续的激励作用。
And as you can see, helping others move forward has been answered most. And well, that also resonates with me, right? Because I truly believe that in principle, we all, of at least most of us, are willing to help others whenever possible, and when we know that it really makes a difference.
我们看到这里面就是回答最多的是认为是帮助他人进步本身就是一种奖励。那我是同意这种看法的，我觉得就是我们至少大多数人都会觉得，如果我们就是帮助他人，并且这个别人能够真的就是能够得到取得进步，或者说真的能够产生变化的话，我们是愿意帮助别人的。
And other rewards that experts find motivating are to create a positive impact, but also networking opportunities was mentioned a couple of times. but also exposure to new job opportunities and to be able to influence the subject matter at hand is considered rewarding. And finally, also, visibility too and recognition from peers and management and their own personal development.Are incentives that resonate with some.
除了就是前面提到的帮助他人进步本身是一种奖励，我们也看到就是这些专家也认为其他的就是对他们来说具有激励作用的，就包括能够创造积极的影响，就是能够拥有拓宽人脉的机会，而且是也包括他们如果能获得接触这个新工作的机会。以及他们能够推动某个主题，然后也是如果能够获得同事和管理层的关注度以及认可，然后以及包括如果能够实现个人发展，这些对他们而言都是能够起到激励作用的。
And of course, we looked at if these rewards are covered enough in the performance support that we provide.And looking at the output of the rapid workflow analysis, and the process labels and the performance report that's based on that, I believe it's fair to say that we foster these incentives with our performance report.
我们前面讲了这个快速工作流程以及相应的结果，还有就是那些过程这个六个，这右上角六个这个过程以及。还有基于这些过程的这个绩效支持，那我觉得我们是可以通过这个绩效支持，然后来促进这些激励因素，然后更好的激励到这些专家。
Yeah, so now we've addressed the capability and the motivation components of the COMB system. Let's take a look at the opportunity component, the opportunity to be an expert.And of course, there are potentially many ways to realize the opportunity. But at Philips, we focus momentarily on four aspects. Discovery of experts, and who are the experts in the organization, and where are they located in the organization. Then the validation and visibility of experts, validation of their expertise, involving their line manager also to create a commitment and making the experts visible so others can find them and benefit from them.The third is the training and guidance for knowledge management and community of practice owners and moderators. Yes, support for experts from relevant stakeholders in their direct environment. And finally, education of people that are searching for a specific expertise. So the users of that knowledge and how to best connect with the experts.
我们刚刚讲了这个专家的能力动机，最后我们来看一下我们如何为专家创造这个成为专家的机会。那这个方法呢有很多，然后在飞利浦我们主要是专注在四个方面。第一个是发现专家，就是谁是专家，然后他们在组织里就是承担的是什么角色。第二个是就是验证这个专家的专业知识，然后我们要让他们的这个直线经理还要做出承诺， 然后我们要帮助这些专家提升他们在组织内部的这个关注度啊，这样呢就方便更多的人知道他们，然后去找到他们。第三个是我们是给予专家支持，那这个支持呢主要是来自于相关的利益相关者，就包括知识管理者、实践社区的所有者和主持人等等。那最后一个是我们会针对这个知识的寻求者，也就是用户，然后提供一些指导，然后帮助他们去知道如何能够更好的、比较准确的与这些专家取得联系。
So if I'm not mistaken, we have a short break now. But after the break, I will go into a bit more detail on these four aspects and to create the opportunity and also provide a short summary of the talk. But first, a short break where I think useful information will be shared regarding the upcoming GO-TKM forum in December.
Thank you, Jasper.
那我们现在就是先短暂的休息一会儿，然后休息之后我会再对这个四个方面进行详细的介绍。那我们现在先休息一会儿，然后由 Fisher 跟大家分享一下我们在12月举办的全球首届组织隐形技能管理论坛。
谢谢 Jasper, OK。那这样的啊，后面我想跟大家分享呢，有一个比较重要的信息跟大家去分享一下，也是个比较好的一个机会。那么这个机会呢，这次呢应该是这样的机会，在国内呢，来国地国来自在国际上都是我们第一次来进行做这事。那这个活动呢，它的等级呢是很高的。那这次呢，我们得到海南省政府的省政府的大力支持，所以这次活动呢，主要由海南省委人才局、国投人力、海南人才集团以及我们蒙科公司以及组织隐形技能管理全球智库共同来举办这么一个活动。那这个活动呢，因为在我们在目前来说，全球没有任何其他地方曾经举办过类似的活动，这是我们第一次在全球进行举办。那时间呢是12月17号18号，地点呢会放在中国海南的海口啊，跟大家去分享一下。那这个论坛呢，我们邀请到全球近50名左右顶尖的关于组织隐形技能管理领域的顶尖专家来跟大家分享。也就是说，在这个领域你所能找到的全球专家、大佬级专家基本上都会在这次论坛里面亮相。其中这次论坛里面还会有两位特别邀请嘉宾，一位是美国国际教练联合会的总裁 Catherine 女士，就 ICF 的全球总裁 Catherine 女士也会过来讲。另外一位是欧洲导师教练协会总裁 Reza 先生也会过来讲。所以这个等级呢是相当高级的，相当高的规格，它是很高的。那么同时呢，当然全球组织隐形技能管理的这个智库的总裁也会过来讲 ，OK。当然我们还有邀请到各大洲里面关于组织隐形技能这个领域的所有的专家，包括一些 ISO 的专家，都会过来去讲这些话题，跟大家去分享。所以这是一个非常难得一个机会啊，跟大家去讲一下这一块。那么这个活动呢是。当然我们也会邀请到很多的企业的实战派人物 CEO 董事长做演讲嘉宾。那原则上我们线下的嘉宾呢局限在180人左右，基本上均为大企业的 CEO 董事长，只是以这么一个级别的。那线上观众呢，最早以前我们想呢可能会在200万左右，那现在来看下来以后呢，这个量呢远远不止，我估计了现在看的样子呢，应该是在300万到500万左右这么一个量啊，观众的量可以达到这么一个等级。那么话题我们原则上有四大板块：总纲篇、萃取篇、传承篇以及职业发展篇，这四大块跟大家去讲一下。那么你如果你呢有兴趣的话啊，你就扫码获票，扫码获票。但那你扫码获票以后，这个票呢 你可以拿到的五大福利。哪五大福利呢？你可以扫了票以后，然后呢你在线上是我们的关是我们的付费观众，你可以获得我们大会讲座的论坛讲座的所有 PPT 中英文版，你可以获得所有的回放资格，这个视频呢应该是在一个月之内你可以无限次回放，但你现场参加直播这个毫无疑问的，你也可以有个社群，就是我们整个在做组织隐形技能管理这个领域的社群，可能包括有中文社群英文社群，你都可以参与进来。同时呢我们会针对所有的听众，他呢在听的过程中遇到哪些问题，我们会集中组织专家进行答疑。所以后面呢我们论坛结束以后呢，我们会组织这样的每周论坛，就是那个每周的这个在线分享。其中呢我们就有一块呢是让过往讲座讲过的这些专家来进行回答同学们的提问，各位朋友的提问。这个提问呢我们事先的都把它集中起来收集起来，来呢给我们的专家进行集中答疑。 OK， 是这样子。那么这个直播门票呢，它的标准价呢是999元，那基本上你可以听到近50场左右的这样讲座。那么今天呢我们的早鸟票呢是699一位，也就是说这个呢到12月7号为止就没有了啊，反正就是每周我们的早鸟票呢是优惠呢优惠幅度呢逐步减小啊，跟大家去讲一下。那么这是如果大家有兴趣呢那你呢对有兴趣的话，欢迎你呢尽快的就是说去购票，越往后面呢你呢可能有月会呢就是说价钱会比较贵一点。甚至我用我们这次呢跟机构去合作的时候，可能有些时候呢如果你呢就是早购票的这些人员，我们可能会给你那个就是说获得的你的直播的通道，可能不一定会那么堵啊。有些呢后面呢你越到后面去了直播通道，我可能没法去保证有些直播通道是不是堵，是不是那个通畅，有时候我也很难讲，因为量太大，我可能有些东西超出我的预料。所以在这种情况呢，如果你的直播通道就是买的早的人，那么我们可能会给你一个就是说那个就是专线的这个直播通道。好吧，这边简单跟大家讲一下。 OK， That's all for my sharing. Thank you, Jasper.
Yes, thank you, Fisher. Let me share my screen again.
Yeah, thank you.
By the way, it's really nice to hear you talking like that. I don't understand a word, but it's a beautiful language, really.
Thank you.
So let me go to the next slide. Yeah, so welcome back. So as I mentioned just before this break, we focus on four aspects to create this opportunity for the experts, the discovery of experts, the validation of expertise and visibility of experts, support from knowledge managers and COP moderators, and educating knowledge seekers. So let's first discuss the discovery of experts.
好，欢迎大家回来。我们刚刚有提到，就是我们在为专家创造机会方面，我们需要关注四个方面。第一个是发现专家，然后第二个是验证专家的这个专业知识，然后并提升专家的关注度。第三个是由知识管理者和实践社群的主持人，然后给予专家支持。第四个是给那些用户知识的用户，也就是知识的寻求者，然后给一定的指导，就是教导他们如何去与专家取得联系。首先我们来看一下，就是如何发现专家。
And the discovery of experts always starts with mapping critical knowledge, because we need to know where to focus on. And here on this slide, you see a picture of an example of a knowledge map issued by the APQC, that's the American Productivity and Quality Center, and they publish lots of best practices and research of various topics, including around knowledge management.
那我们发现专家呢，首先就是从绘制关键知识的地图做起。大家看右边这张表，这张表是 APQC， 是美国生产力和质量中心，然后他们发布的一个知识地图。那这个 APQC 中心呢，他们平时是就是发布各种针对各种主题的这个最佳实践和研究，然后其中呢就包括这个知识管理相关的这个话题。
So basically what we do is we identify the topics belonging to a certain domain. And then when we have these topics and possibly subtopics, we assess what knowledge is needed to execute on those topics. And then we can identify who the experts are on these knowledge domains. And the knowledge or the experts are not only selected by the level of knowledge or how knowledgeable they are, but there are also other relevant criteria, for example, related to their interpersonal skills.
那首先就是我们会就是针对一个某个领域，然后确定几个主题，然后这个主题呢，这些主题，然后我们会评估，就这些主题它需要哪些知识。然后呢，并且确定谁具备这些知识，也就是哪些人是专家。那我们在挑选专家的时候，就不仅要基于他们的这个知识水平，也有其他的这个标准，比如说他们的这个人际交往能力。
And if no experts are known, we need to take action to fill those gaps, because if there is not an expert on critical knowledge need, then we're at risk of losing our competitive advantage. So that could mean that we have to broaden our search for experts, or we have to create a personal development journey for high potentials, or another option could be to hire a new employee or to buy expertise. But there are potentially other ways to fill those gaps. And the actual preferred way forward in closing these gaps really depends on the situation in those domains.
那如果就是我们针对某个主题，我们缺少这方面的专家，那我们自然要去想着如何去弥补这个空白。那这个具体的方法呢，比如说我们可以是为我们所具备的那些高潜力人才，给他们制定一个发展路线。然后我们也可以去就是扩大一个搜索范围，我们可以去雇佣新的员工，或者说直接购买那些专业知识。那具体采用哪种方式呢，主要取决于你所选的这个领域它这个主题的相关的情况。
And another way to or another element of providing the opportunity to experts is validating their expertise and making the experts and their expertise visible throughout the company. And to that end, we developed a platform with a database of relevant resources, such as CUPs, but also expert profiles. And those expert profiles are again connected to the corporate active directory.
那第二个就是我们为专家提供机会的这个方面，就是要验证我们专家所具备的这个专业知识，然后并且让他们以及他们具备的专业知识在公司内部能够得到体现，也就是能够让大家看到。然后为此呢，我们就开发了一个数据库平台，这个平台里面就有各种各样的资源，就是它包括这个各种的实践社群，也包括我们专家的这个各种档案资料。那这个具体的社群呢，它也是跟企业的这个具体的活动目录是挂钩的。
And this portal is available to all Philips employees, and it also includes an automated validation process as one of the functionalities. So everybody can simply request an expert profile via the portal by submitting a request form. And you see the form here as an example, as a screenshot on this slide.
我们飞利浦所有的员工都可以访问这个门户网站，而这个网站里它有一个自动的验证功能，那每个人呢都可以，就是当你需要比如说已经 需要专业知识的时候，你是可以就是在这个门户网站里去提交这个申请表，然后可以请求获得一份这个专家的资料。
Yeah, so and everybody can simply request an expert profile, and you can request that for yourself or for somebody else in the organization. And when the request is submitted, both the expert and their line manager, they receive an automated notification to assess the request and to approve the request.
然后这个申请呢，我们就是个人，他可以为自己申请，也可以为组织里的其他人，然后申请需要这个专家的资料。然后当这个申请提交以后，那个这个相应的专家以及这个专家的部门经理会收到这个自动的通知，然后他们会对这个然后具体的去评估，然后决定是否批准这样的请求。
Yeah, and part of the process is to justify their approval and confirmation that they acknowledge what is expected of being an expert, but also of being a people manager of an expert. And only once they both have approved, an expert profile will be published in the portal. And on this slide, you also see an example of an expert profile.
这个批准呢是需要同时获得这个专家以及他的这个部门经理两个人都需要就是进行批准和确认，那只有在他们批准以后，这个专家的资料就会在这个某户网站上公布，然后大家看这个图片上就有一个专家的资料这个截图。
Yeah, and this might seem like a formal procedure, and it is actually a formal procedureAnd it might also scare away some people, but at least we know with a certain confidence that the people with an expert profile published are indeed committed.
那这个程序呢，就是我们看应该是比较全面的，因为事实也是，确实我们用下来也确实是的，发现这个程序它非常的实用全面，但有的人可能会被吓跑。但至少就是我们还是有一定的把握知道，就是然后这些愿意就是把自己的这个资料发布出来的专家，他们是就是愿意参与其中，然后做这样的贡献的。
So we put also a lot of effort into providing support to knowledge managers and community of practice owners and moderators, and to empower them to support the experts.
那第三部分就是我们对知识管理者然后实践社群的所有者和主持人，我们也对他们进行了培训和指导，然后以便他们也给专家给予支持。
Yeah, so I'm part of the global knowledge management team, which is a fairly small team, and we adopted a federated operating model, meaning that throughout the organizationPeople practice knowledge management locally in their domain, and these people act as knowledge managers or COP moderators, depending on the concept that they are practicing.
那我呢是飞利浦全球知识管理团队的一员。那我们这个团队，我们采取的是联合运作模式。这个具体怎么说，就是我们在整个组织中，比如说某个特定的领域，然后我们会由这个特定领域的专业人士，然后进行在这个领域内进行知识管理。那这些人他充当的就是这个知识管理者和实践社群的主持人或所有者的角色。那我们是跟他们一起，然后合作，然后实施这个知识管理的。
Yeah, and together with them, we co-create and implement the knowledge management capability. So imagine.And they are the orchestra making the magic, then we, the global team, act as the conductor. And they play a really a vital role in making knowledge management a success, including the success we achieve related to the experts in their domain.
那可以，大家可以想象一下，就是比把他们这些，比如这些知识管理者，我们把他们去比喻成这个管弦乐队，那我们。团队我们发挥的就是这个指挥者的角色，那我们就是一起然后共同的去 创建去提升这个知识管理的能力。那我们在这个知识管理实践方面也确实获得了就是很大的成功，然后我们的这个成功也包括就是跟这些专家相关的这个成功。
Yeah, and to support the knowledge management and the SUP owners and moderators, we also have developed training and guidance specifically suited for their role, and also based on the five moments of needs framework. And on this slide, you see a screenshot of one of the slides that we use in the training for knowledge managers. And here you can see, for example, 8 steps. How the knowledge manager can support the experts in 8 steps.
为了给这些知识管理者的支持呢，我们也针对他们就是专门制定了这个定制的培训和指导。那大家看这个右边的这个图，然后这个呢是我们对这些知识管理者进行培训的其中一张图。这张图上它涉及到了就是知识管理者去如何支持专家的8个步骤。
And there's also a community of practice for knowledge management practitioners throughout the company.So they can also share best practices with each other, address questions, discuss challenges, share lessons learned, and so on.
我们对这些知识管理者也，然后也去创建了相应的这个社群，实践社群，也是通过这个社群方便他们去分享自己的最佳实践，然后探讨遇到的问题以及挑战等等。
So the last aspect of helping create opportunity is to educate people that seek expertise. And the aim is twofold. First, we want the experts to spend their precious time well, and we help them by ensuring that the requests they get are of the highest quality. And the second aim is that we also want that the knowledge seekers get the high quality support they need, and consequently, the benefits of that in their work.
然后在帮助专家创造的这一块呢，最后一点我们是对这个知识的寻求者，也就是用户，给予他们也相应的指导。这个指导的目的主要是有两方面，首先是我们就是自然希望专家他能够合理高效的利用他们的宝贵时间，就确保他们收到的那些请求是最高质量的。然后其次我们也希望这些知识的寻求者他们也能够得到他们需要的这个高质量的支持，然后也因此能够在工作中受益。
Yeah, we achieve this by guiding the knowledge seekers, so the end users, on how to connect with experts. And here on the slide, you see an example of the guidelines for connecting with medical experts. It is expected, for example, that people first look at existing resources for knowledge. And if they don't find what they need,they should draft a clear briefing so the experts can assess and prepare the requests. It's also encouraged to contact a relevant community of practice or center of excellence around the topic at hand. After all, there might be more people that could provide support. And actually, based on my experiences, asking questions in a well-run community of practice could give you far more insights than you would have expected at first.
那我们为了是我们给这些用户指导呢，我们主要是指导他们如何去与专家建立联系。那下面就是这个图上就是我们在飞普做的就是一个例子，我们是如何就是让用户与这个医疗飞普的医疗专家然后取得联系。首先呢是对就是这个用户啊，他首先要对自己现有的知识资源进行一个盘点然后查找。然后如果他们没有找到他们需要的那些知识，那么他们就需要去起草一份比较明确的简报，也就是说这个知识的这个申请，然后把这个申请提交，然后以便让这个专家再去进行评估和批准。那其实我们也就是在联系专家之前，其实我们也鼓励他们这些用户去联系到就相应的这个实践社群或者说卓越中心，因为这样的话可能有更多的人可以就是给予他们帮助。因为根据我自己的经验的话，就是一个比较运作的比较良好的一个实践社群，它其可以给你带来你超出预期的这个知识分享。
And if you then still don't have the desired outcome, you can obviously schedule a session with an expert. And I also want to emphasize the last bullet point, because it's the last one, but certainly not the least. It is expected that learnings and collaboration results are also shared through proper channels and within relevant communities. After there was a session with experts or contact with a community of practice or center of excellence.
如果就是联系到这个实践社区或者卓越中心，你依然没有得到你想要的这个结果的话，那你可以去安排一次与专家的这个会谈。那最后呢，就是我们是就是希望就是通过建立这些适当的渠道以及社群，然后供大家去分享和学习这个合作，学习然后合作，然后去然后大家一起分享，然后再一起得到自己想要的这些知识成果。
Yeah, so that was in short the four aspects of helping create opportunity for the experts. I think we've reached the end of my presentation. So I just want to share also my key takeaways from this talk. First of all, to empower experts and get their commitment, we need to focus on three drivers of behavioral change: capability, motivation, and opportunity.
好，那我们现在呢，我们讲座已经进入尾声了。那我先来总结一下，就是今天主要的收获。首先是我们就是为了为专家赋能，然后并且能够让他们参与进来，我们需要关注这行为改变的三个因素，就是能力、动机和机会。
Yeah, and with the training materials, the online guide, and the community of practice for experts, we ensure that the experts have the right skills and knowledge and making them capable.
在能力方面，我们通过提供相应的培训材料、在线指南以及建立专家社群，我们确保专家是拥有我们需要的这个技能和知识。
And we also stimulate the incentives that truly matter to these experts, help others, create an impact, networking opportunities, exposure, visibility and recognition, and influence and personal development. And experts have the opportunity because they are discovered and they are visible. And their expertise is validated by the line manager, creating also their commitment. They also get the support from relevant stakeholders in their direct environment. And knowledge seekers are instructed on how to connect with these experts, so they receive high quality requests.
那除了能力以外，第二个是我们了解到了对专家而言那些真正重要的激励因素，它包括能够帮助他人，然后建立影响力，能够拓宽自己的人脉，有曝光，有关注度，有认可，然后有影响力和也能实现个人的发展。然后在为专家创造机会方面呢，我们是要让专家能够被发现，然后他们的知识得到验证，然后他们被看见，然后也得到部门经理的承诺，也让他们得到相关实力相关者的支持，以及最后我们需要只对知识的用户进行指导，然后帮助他们要然后更好的与专家建立联系。
Yeah, and with that, we've come to the end of this talk. So I would like to thank you very much for your time and attention. It was really my pleasure to be here with you all. And I hope this talk was interesting and helpful for you. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Jasper.
感谢大家的今天花时间，然后参加今天的讲座，也非常高兴跟大家聚在这里，也希望我今天的分享对大家有所帮助。谢谢。
Thank you, Jasper. OK.
Thank you.
那我们非常感谢 Jasper 先生呢，跟我们分享了飞利浦公司的真实的知识管理方面的一些实践，这些东西呢，在我们肯平时生活中都很难能见到的。那么 ，OK， 那 any questions from our audience？ 大家有哪些问题吗？有问题，这时候可以问出来啊。我们难得有找到专家去给你解答。Any questions？
Hi, Jasper. Fisher. This is Michelle.
Hi, Michelle.
I have actually several questions. from the very beginning, a document. The first one, Jasper, you mentioned a lot about performance. I would like to understand the definition of this performance is KPI or, your performance result driven, or is a target to the specific behaviors or skills need to be demonstrated in the expert field. So that's where it will be a little bit different.
Yeah, I think you refer to the performance supports that we've developed and that we provide to our experts, right?
Yep.
Yeah, so with the performance support, what we did is we looked at the, let's say, the tasks that experts execute in playing that role. And based on those tasks, we identified what knowledge do they need to execute on these tasks. And that is what we incorporated in the performance supporting materials. Yeah, okay. So we, let's say, assume that if they can execute their task well with our support, that they can also perform well in the workflow. And of course, that should then lead to impact on personal KPIs, but of course also on business KPIs. But that is, let's say, that follows from them being a good expert.
Okay, yeah, thank you. It's very helpful. Yeah.
Is that answering your question?
That's what I guess. Yes, that's what I guess, but would like to validate. Thank you.
Yeah, and that we often get this question, right? How is knowledge management impacting our business KPIs? So, and basically what I want to know is how much money can we earn with knowledge management? Or how much more productivity do we get with knowledge management? And of course, we are trying various ways to also quantify that, but that's quite difficult. And we believe that it's better to also use proxies, indicators that don't say directly something about, for example, the profit that you make or the cost that you have, but they do say something indirectly. And if you have enough proxy indicators, then yeah, you could also say something about the impact they have on your business KPIs. But it's a very, yeah, thank you for the question. It's a very relevant question. And I think we can spend a whole afternoon talking about that topic as well.
Yeah.
Thank you.
第一个问题呢，是我们刚才说的这个，就是我们给予专家这个 performance support。那这个 performance 具体是指我们平常所说的这个 KPI， 还是说我们在基于就是具体的某个行为或者技能，然后需要达到的成果结果？那我们这个其实这里我们刚才也提到了，就是我们在很多流程下面，然后我们把它就是具体的分组了，就很多的任务。然后这个任务呢，主要是就是专家所需要执行的任务，他在这些任务中所扮演的角色，然后他完成这些任务所需要的知识。那这个 performance 应该是说他更多可能在这个执行扮演他的角色，然后他的这个表现，因为我们是基于他这个表现然后给他提供相应的支持的。那如果他在这个任务中表现比较好的话，那自然这个知识的流动就更加的顺畅。所以这个我们所以这里的 performance 吧，更多的应该是说，其实他就是在执行这个任务中的表现。当然，他也就是涉及到我们平时谈到的，就是商业上的这种绩效的 KPI 啊，这个自然它也是有一定相关的。
So,
okay.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Can ask more? Yes.
Yes, sure. Yeah, you can ask. Okay.
Yeah, thank you. The second question is still related to the performance result. If the expert really to contribute some time from, take out from their day-to-day work to do the, you know, the coaching or mentoring to help others, how do you or say how do you really manage the workload for the experts? Because somebody are really popular in the company, everybody wants this person to be the mentor or helper. Yeah,
very good question. Thank you. So, and it's a difficult question to answer, actually, but I'll do my best. So first of all, there are things that the experts can do by themselves. We always strongly advise experts to discuss with their line manager how much time they can spend on doing this general expert mm-hmm. work. Apart from that, we also encourage the experts to make being an expert and the tasks that belong to that, make it part of your personal work objectives. And we have this human resources cycle in place at Philips where you set some targets at the beginning of the year. And this is what I want to achieve this year. And then when after the year has passed, then it's always our time to also pause and reflect on the previous year together with your line manager and see how well you have performed on your objectives. And making, for example, being a mentor part of your objectives helps you also to get commitment from, in this case, then the line manager, so you can also spend time on it. So that's one thing. Another thing that we also advise, at least to have some kind of decision tree structured or in mind, or you can also write it out, where you can, for example, say, if I have income requests, the first I'm going to do is to check if it's really within the scope of my expertise. And if it is, then I'm going to check, for example, this is just an example, then I'm going to check if the efforts to respond to such requests, if it fits into my time budget that I agreed with my line manager. And if it fits in my time budget, then I'm going to check if I can do it within 5 minutes. Because if it's within 5 minutes, I'm taking action immediately, because otherwise I get a whole long list of small tasks. But if it's not, if it requires a bit more effort, then I should plan it in my regular work planning. But also, for example, if you decision where you have no, for example, it does not fit within my scope of expertise, or it does not fit within my agreed time allocation, my time budget, then you can also define appropriate actions when that situation occurs. And it helps you structuring at least your thoughts about when you get a specific request. And it also helps you in managing your time, because you know what the appropriate response is to a certain request. So, but these are just some examples of how we can at least lower the burden to experts as much as possible. Another way, for example, could be, if that's okay, if I can share another example. Another example could be to really have people use community of practices first before contacting an individual expert. Because, for example, if you ask a question within a community, there might be an expert that could support you who has a bit more time available at that moment than another expert that you had in mind to ask. So then, let's say the pool of experts that you have access to is, of course, larger than if you only focus on one individual.
Thank you.
I hope this helps.
Yes.
Thanks for the question.
第二个问题呢，是就是我们。 因为就是讨论到我们专家的这个贡献问题，就是比如说我们日常我们是需要专家，他就从他的日常工作里，然后抽出一定的时间，比如说给其他人做这个导师和教练的工作，那这个对专家而言就可能意味着这个工作量的增加。那如何就是这些专家该如何去应对这种 是工作量的增加，因为毕竟因为组织里我们有些专家他是非常受欢迎的，大家都想找他帮忙。那这个问题呢就是也是问得很好的，然后我呢就是给一些建议，就是首先我们就是需要这个专家他可以就是跟他的部门经理可以讨论，就是他可以就是比如说针对这个他的这个专业知识技能跟别人分享的话，他可能需要就是花出多少时间，然后对他自己的工作有没有一定的影响。那我们其实在飞利浦我们也是经常就是鼓励专家，然后把这样就是这样的就是知识分享工作，然后以把它列为他这个这一年的可能这一年的目标，然后在年终的时候，然后这个专家呢我们就是停下来去思考一下就是过去一年然后在这方面所做的贡献，以及在就是各个方面各个工作任务方面所取得的一个结果，然后一个平衡情况。然后呢他也可以跟他的部门经理讨论这个他的这个年度这个目标指标的完成是否需要调整还怎么样的。那第二个呢是这个专家他也可以就是对可以比如说运用一些工具，他可以比如说自己可能画一个绘制一个决策树，或者是思考或者是写下来。就首先针对他收到的那些专业知识的请求，他首先要确认这些就是需要的专业技能是不是跟他是匹配的，然后他也看一下自己的这个日程表，然后是否就是跟自己的时间也能够匹配。就如果说有的可能需要的专业知识他并不需要花那么多的时间，那他在可能获得这个部门经理同意的情况下，他就可以就是快速的去做出这个贡献。但是如果可能需要花费他大部分的时间和精力的话，那他可能就需要去再权衡一下他的这个时间分配问题了。所以第三个就是我刚才也建议了，就是在我们向某个专家去寻求这个知识的时候，我们可以去考虑向这个实践社群或者卓越中心然后去请求帮助，因为在这里你可能能够获得就是更多人的支持，因为在这里可能有的专家他这个时间不一定有空，但有的专家他可能有空，那他就可以给你一个帮助。那以上呢是我的一些建议。
Wow, I see. Wow, this must be challenging to translate all that. And apologies,、
yeah.
I should have paused more often.
Yeah, very challenging for him, for her, yes. Okay, 其他还有哪些问题吗？各位朋友。OK, 如果没什么其他问题，因为今天的时间呢也比较晚了。OK。OK, so Michelle, I have one more question. How long did you take to implement this?
I see it in the chat, yeah. So how long did you take to implement this knowledge management process globally? And what is the biggest challenge to establish this culture?Yeah, it's a good question. And actually, to be honest, this is really a continuous journey. So we are still implementing, and there's continuously we learn more and we have to adjust and improve. And I believe that's a continuous cycle that we keep on doing. And we're one of the excellence practices within Philips, which I explained also a bit with our federated model and how we support the organization. And yeah, it could take some time to get people on board. To be honest, it could take some time. But also you notice when you can deliver some value and they really experience also that value in their domain.Then people get really enthusiastic about it. And then, let's say, the train is moving faster and faster. And that's good to see. And there are many challenges also to face. First of all, we are a globally operating company. That means that we have employees from all over the world. And every individual is different, but also individuals from a specific area in the world, they have a specific culture.They have a specific organizational culture, but also a national culture. So there are many, many, many variables that could impact also, let's say, the success of such an initiative. And I have to be honest also, sometimes it is not working as we hoped for, but then we have to learn from it. See, do a problem solving analysis, ask ourselves, for example, 5 times why something was different than expected. And then we often come to a certain course that we can actually influence and make it better and make it stick and make it a more success. But it's a continuous effort, and you have to keep I'm not sure if it's a proper English expression, but translate from Dutch, you have to keep the finger on the pulse to constantly check how it is going and act on it. I hope that's a satisfying answer. Oh, it's also from you, Michel. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anything else?
刚才的问题呢是就是比如说我们的飞利浦在全球然后实施这个知识管理过程需要花多长时间，那这个呢是一个持续的过程，因为这个是我们在这个过程里不断学习不断调整不断改进的一个过程，它是一个循环。那我们这个时间呢其实确实是比如说你首先你需要就是把一定的这个专业人士是聚集在一起，这个确实是需要花费一定时间的。然后呢就是但是在这个之后，然后大家就是开始然后贡献自己的经验，贡献自己的价值，然后这个在有些情况呢这个就可能可以推进这个知识管理过程的这个进行。那在这个过程我们也确实遇到很多的挑战，因为像飞利浦是一个它是一个全球化的公司，那我们员工也是来自世界各地的，就是我们有不同国家的文化，也有比如说不同的组织的文化，那确实有很多因素会影响我们这个项目的成功。确实有时候呢这个项目它确实就是应该说是确实有失败的时候，那更重要的是我们会从这个失败里我们会吸取一些经验教训，会去分析。那我们也有很多时候呢它的确实是让我们确实是取得了就是一个也是有取得成功的时候，所以这个呢是一个我们需要持续付出然后持续就不断的去调整的一个过程，它是一个长期的持续的过程。
OK
yeah, 好 there is another question in the chat box, what's the difference between external and internal expertise?
Oh, that's a question for me, right?So the, I think that question is referring to
the chat box.
When I talked about filling those gaps, I'm not sure if it's referring to that, but with internal expertise, I'm making some assumptions about the question, but the internal expertise is the expertise that we have in-house available. And if you have to buy expertise externally,that means that from outside of the company, we buy or hire that expertise. So that somebody from outside of the company that has that expertise, that we, let's say, buy or hire. But I'm not sure if that was the context of the question.
这个问题他可能就是问的是这个内部，应该是可能是组织内部和外部的这个就是专业知识技能的这个区别，因为刚才就是我们提到如果说我们内部就是有相应的专家的话，也就是我们具备了相应的这个专业知识，但如果我们内部可能就是没有相应的专家，没有这个相应的专业知识的时候，我们可以就是从公司外面去购买这个相应的专业知识，或者说我们可以是重新就是可以招聘雇佣，就是外部的这个从外部招聘这个专业的人才。
Okay, so in that case, I think, because time constraint, due to time limit, so we have to stop here. And then, thank you very much, Jasper, for your wonderful sharing. And think this is very, very knowledgeable and practical for us.
Thank you very much, Fisher.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this. So before the end of the session, I also
want to explain to our audience that we need to collect their feedback on our webinar. So, 那在这个论坛最后部分呢，我希望就是能够邀请到各位朋友花一点时间，能够给我们这个论坛呢给一点反馈，扫码给我们提供一个反馈表，好吗？谢谢你。那同时呢，下一期我们会有请到在来自于南非的维内教授给大家分享如何整合各类技术助力组织隐形技能萃取。也就是说，在我们有很多这个组织隐形技能，那你萃取之后，你怎么把它给找出来呢？怎么把它给挖出来？那么在这种情况呢，那么维内教授会跟大家分享呢，有哪些比较流行的这些方法论，这些工具可以帮助大家怎么去萃取它，好吗？这个当然也是我们今年2022的最后一场这个组织隐形技能管理讲座。那么接下去以后呢，这场讲座12月7号这场讲座结束以后呢，我们就会进入到12月17号这次的论坛。那么然后我们今年2022所有的讲座全部到此。那么所以呢，基本上这次呢，那12月7号这次也是温念教授给我们做了一场压轴戏啊，希望各位朋友呢能够持续关注我们的论坛。那基本上我们的论坛呢讲的全是一帮全球在这个领域里面非常资深的专业的实战派老师给大家去分享的啊。好，那么因为这个讲座呢在全球任何其他地方你基本上找不到的，所以呢只有我们在全球在做这么一块东西的，好吗？所以有欢迎大家呢持续关注我们。那最后呢，我在想呢，我们真正的诚挚的邀请各位朋友把我们的系列讲座分享给你身边的朋友啊，我们叫送人玫瑰手有余香，拯救组织隐形技能助人振起强国，推动组织隐形技能萃取和传承在中国乃至全球的发展，造福社会。我们不仅要倡议拯救组织隐形技能，更要研究组织隐形技能萃取管理传承的方法，更重要的是在全社会普及，好吗？好，那在最后再次感谢大家参与，让我们12月7号晚上19点再见。